Welcome to What Chelsea Eats. I don't know if anybody's on there tonight. I mean, this afternoon, tonight. It's bright as day, and I'm talking about tonight. So, anyway, today I wanted to come on and just talk to you briefly about iodine deficiency. It's something that people don't ordinarily think about, but I want to talk about it because a lot of people struggle with like feeling lethargic, their hair is falling out, they are, let's see, I have a whole list. They have headaches, brain fog, shortness of breath, muscle weakness is a big one, joint stiffness, depression, difficulty losing weight, dry skin, hyperlipidemia, that's when you've got too many fat cells in your blood. Recurrent infections. I don't know how many times I find people who are always sick. Like they always have some type of infection, a sinus infection, like every season. It's been a couple of years since I've been sick with that kind of sickness, like infections all the time. But a lot of people get them all the time. And the cold hands and feet thing. Now, you could be anemic if you have cold hands and feet, but also having cold hands and feet could be a sign of having an iodine deficiency as well. So that's something to look at. And depression. But I want to talk about it a little bit, about how it relates to women's health in general. A lot of people don't know this because nobody talks about it, really. But our uterus, our ovaries, and our breasts specifically need iodine to work properly. As a matter of fact, we need either 12 milligrams or 12,000 micrograms of iodine every day, so just to keep up with the demand our body needs so that it'll function normally as women. So, for example, if you have what I'm always talking about, fibroids, endometriosis, ovarian cyst, any type of female issue, 9 times out of 10, you are deficient in iodine. And it's not in the food like it used to be. I think there were a couple different foods that they used to add iodine to, and one being table salt. And I'm not really sure if it's added to table salt anymore, but I'm not a proponent of table salt anyway, even if it did have iodine in it, because it's really bad for you. So if you're going to consume any salt, you want to use the best salt you possibly can. And in my opinion, it's any type of a mineral salt, like a pink Himalayan crystal salt or a Celtic sea salt. And even those two salts don't have iodine added to them. So if you are not a heavy sea vegetable eater, like seaweed, nori, you know, dulse, kelp, those things, you need to supplement with it just so that you can have the amount of iodine in your system that we need in order for our female organs really to work normally. But whether you're a man or a woman, iodine deficiency can affect you negatively. And this here, I don't know if I can zoom in on it, probably not, but I'll tell you, I'll put a link below as to what this is. This is liquid iodine, and this is from the Dr. Clark's store. And it's Lugol's iodine. It's the best iodine that I've been able to find on the market. And not only that, it's really cheap. It's a couple dollars for, I mean, like $4 or $5 for this bottle of iodine. And it's pretty potent. I recommend this one because it is potent. Like I literally could feel it in my body. Unfortunately, I don't take it as often as I would like to take it. Really, I'm supposed to take it every day to get that 12,000 or 12 milligrams of iodine, but I don't because I forget sometimes. But I try to take it as often as I can. But when I do, I can feel in my body that it's actually doing something. So to test yourself without having to go to the doctors, I don't even know if there is, sorry about that, if there is an actual test that you can take at the doctor's office to test your iodine levels. I'm sure there is. I don't know that if you say, hey doc, can you test my iodine levels, if they would actually do it, because They don't typically like to test for things like that, but you can do it at home yourself. All you do is buy a bottle of iodine, a real potent bottle. The liquid in here is like a deep red color. I don't know, back in the 70s when I was a little girl, my grandmother, when I got a cut or a scrape or something like that, she would put something called mercurochrome. I can't pronounce it. You people who are 70s babies, you know what mercurochrome is. I can't say it properly, but you know what I'm talking about. And it was like this red ointment they would put, or a liquid they would put on the sore. And it actually would make the cut feel better. It like would, I guess, bring down the inflammation. So that's what this looks like. So what you would do is you take the inside of your wrist, and you would paint some of this. You can take a Q-tip or something like that and paint like a square on your arm before you go to bed. Go to sleep, and when you wake up in the morning, if the square is gone or faded, then yes, mercurochrome. Is that how you say it? My dad called it monkey blood. That's funny. Yeah, but it worked when we were young, so I've not seen it in years, but it did work. But if you put that on your wrist, the patch test on your wrist. Hey, stop, drop, and roll on. How you doing, girl? Thanks for joining. So if you put that on your wrist and you go to sleep, and in the morning, if the iodine patch is gone, that means that you are deficient in iodine and you really need to start taking it immediately so that you can build up your iron, iodine level. So yeah, that's one to say that about iodine, but we need iodine so that we can function normally. Like, so if you're walking through your day and you have foggy thinking, you know, you're depressed all the time. Like, I'm telling you, sometimes these mineral deficiencies, they will have you acting a fool. I'm telling you, you'll be walking around all emotional and your hormones are all out of whack, and you're like, what's the matter with me? And you go to the doctors and they say, well, you're perfectly healthy. Well, you could be deficient in some minerals. And unfortunately, doctors, it's not that they don't care, but they don't have time to spend with us to see really what's wrong with us. So we have to take care of our own self. We have to decide what's right for ourselves. So, I'm so sorry, but we have to take care of ourselves. And you know, if we're deficient in something, we're responsible for making sure that we are not deficient anymore. As a matter of fact, some of you watched me walk through that anemia battle that I went through, and I didn't know what was wrong with me. I thought it was thyroid, and I didn't know what it was, but I finally figured it out. And even when my doctor tested me and figured out what it was, she was just kind of like, oh, I mean, like it wasn't a big deal. Hey, Tossin. So I'm the one who had to say, okay, I needed to, and all they had a lot is 15 minutes. And yes, we need to take care of ourselves. They don't have time. They just don't. And then it's not really their fault. I mean, there's a whole lot of different factors involved into why they cannot spend the time with us. So we have to know our own bodies. So if you are deficient in something, you need to do the work to get yourself efficient. I mean, not deficient anymore. So that's why I recommend doing this little patch test on your arm for iodine. You can get this on Amazon. I'll put a link below eventually, at least maybe by the end of the day, you'll see a link below for this. Or you can go to your Whole Foods market, your health food store, and get yourself some iodine and do a patch test for yourself. And I wasn't going to talk about this, but anemia, I started talking about it. Regular practitioners, they don't understand how anemia really affects somebody. Like, I mean, they just don't. They see your iron is low, they say, go take some iron pills. And it doesn't always work that way. It doesn't always work to help. You don't know how many people that I have talked to, and they say, why take the iron pills? Nothing is helping. Well, it's because you're not absorbing it. And you need more than the 15 minutes that you get at the doctor's. I mean, I get about 20 minutes if I get a physical. Maybe. And that's because I push it. Because I'm like always asking questions and my doctor's trying to leave the room and all that stuff, and I don't let it happen. That's just my personality. But everybody is, you know, you got to take care of yourself. You got one life to live, one body to live in, and we cannot depend on other people to make sure that we're okay. Do y'all have some questions y'all want me to answer? Since there's four people on here, if you have some questions, please feel free to ask at this moment. I'll wait for a minute. So I saw Stop, Drop, and Roll On. I saw Tossin. Is there anybody else that wants to identify themselves? I can't remember the first person's name that came up, and they told me about the Mercurochrome. Thank you. I'm glad to see you. Margaret, hey Tina, how you doing? I would love to see some of your paintings on your Facebook wall. I haven't seen anything lately. I'm glad. Anybody else have any more have any questions? So, well, you can get back into the painting. I know you will. That's your call, that painting. You have some beautiful pieces. Chlorophyll. You want me to talk more about chlorophyll? Okay. So, chlorophyll, of course, we all know that it is from a plant. It is the sun shining down on the plant to make, it's like plant blood. It's like blood of the, it's the blood of the plant. I think that's the best way to describe it. And you've been using table salt. Yeah, get that Himalayan crystal salt or the Celtic salt. It's worth the switch. You will feel it in your body if you are salt, if you use salt. But as far as the chlorophyll is concerned, you can take liquid chlorophyll to up your iron levels or to build your blood. But I think my favorite is the wheatgrass growing did not work very much. Oh yeah, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work to keep it growing. I mean, if you can do it and you can do it consistently, growing wheatgrass is like, it's fabulous. That stuff is good for you. Like, you'll get a punch from using it, but it's not easy to keep up with it, especially when you work and you got all that other stuff you got to do. It's tough. I was going to say something about, what's becoming my favorite way to get the chlorophyll in my body is through herbal teas. So I am a dandelion green and stinging nettles fanatic these days. Like, I have two jars on my counter sitting for me to drink later. I mean, like, because it seems like not only does it give me that chlorophyll or chlorophyll kick, but it seems like it just gives me all the other vitamins and minerals that I need for my body too, without having to swallow back a whole bunch of pills. I have a huge, yes, I'll tell you in just a second. I have a huge container with all kinds of supplements in there, and they're good. They're good supplements, but I find myself having a hard time actually, you know, swallowing pills every day. Okay, so my stinging nettles tea, I get it in bulk. I buy a big bag of it because I use it every day, and I use a lot of it. I use about an inch worth in a mason jar. So I put 4 big tablespoons in there along with 4 tablespoons of dandelion greens. And I get them from Amazon. I'll put a link below so you guys can see which ones I get. They are... they're dried, so they're not processed in the way where all the minerals and vitamins are out of them. Like, they cut them, they process them like as safely as possible so that you can, it retains all the nutrients. And then when you use it for your tea, I boil water or just before boil, and I pour the water over top of the tea, the herbs. I use mason jars, either 4 cup or 8 cup mason jars, depending on how much tea I'm making. I pour that water over there, and I usually do it at night or first thing in the morning, 5-6 o'clock in the morning. And I just let it sit for at least 4 hours, but the longer it sits, the better. So I like to do it at night and then drink it in the morning, like strain the water from the tea in the morning and drink it throughout my day as my water. That's what I like to do. I feel like it gives me the most bang for my buck as far as herbs are concerned. I like the stinging nettles, the dandelion greens. I like red raspberry tea now. I've started looking at that one. And there's another one that I use every single day, and that's hibiscus tea. And hibiscus tea is good for the skin. It's good for your female health, even your breast and your female organs. But it's good for for your skin. I mean, that stuff is powerful. So if you're on the verge of high blood pressure, drink some hibiscus tea. That will knock it out. I mean, I'm no doctor. You know, I'm not trying to tell you not to take your high blood pressure pills or anything like that. But if you want to get off them, if you want to get off of high blood pressure pills, or you don't want to start taking them because you're on the verge, hibiscus tea is a good one to make too. One day I'm going to do a video while I'm making them. The problem is usually when I'm making the tea, I'm making it at night or early in the morning, and it's dark and the lighting is just terrible. So maybe I'll just do it anyway and y'all will be okay with it, because everybody always asks me how to make that tea. So I'm going to do it eventually. What I've found is that the key to health is to stop all the crappy living, and feed my body with as much nutrients as I possibly can in the form of whole, ripe fruits and vegetables, as much and raw as possible. I did a video earlier. It'll post, I guess, either Thursday or next week. I can't remember when, but I was just saying that I was given an idea of what I actually eat. So for breakfast, I try to eat like a juice or a smoothie. Most of the time, it's a smoothie these days because I'm too busy. And for lunch, it's either a smoothie or some type of leftover like soup that I made or something like that. But most of the time, it's like a smoothie. It could be a salad, but a smoothie, yeah, because it's quick during the morning. I mean, for lunch. And then for dinner, I'll have like a big salad, and you guys have seen salad videos that I've made, and they're not like little tiny salads where I'm like, you know, a few cucumbers and a tomato. I make huge salads. My bowls are bowls that like most people use for when they are serving a family. That's what I eat. And people will say, that's all you're going to eat, I'll get two extremes. That's all you're going to eat, or they'll say, you're going to eat all of that. Well, eating that has caused me not to be sick anymore. So if that's what it takes, then that's what I'm going to do. Anybody have any other questions they want to ask? Oh, and if you are interested, if you haven't already, my webinar is going to be on Sunday, October the 1st at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And it is Foods to Avoid to Shrink Fibroid Tumors. That's what the webinar is. And some of you have my ebook that I wrote for that purpose. But what I'm going to be doing in that webinar is discussing in more detail about those foods and why they're bad and why we shouldn't eat them if we're trying to shrink fibroids. And also, it's not really about just fibroids. It's kind of like, don't eat those foods. The foods are bad for us, and they cause us not to feel good, and for whatever reason, we're attached to them. And I'm not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, not trying to portray that, but the reason that we have a lot of the sicknesses and diseases that we do have is because of what we put in our mouth and the thoughts we think and the things we drink. So if you haven't already signed up for that webinar, it's free. All you have to do is click below. I think the link is already there. You can sign up. But anyway. Okay, can you send an email link for the webinar, Chelsea? The link, I don't know if you can look below. It's right below this video. There, it should be in the information box. If I don't see your name come through, Miss Tina, I'll send you a link to the page. And so you can sign up for the webinar. So is there any other questions? I'm so excited. I have so many things coming down the pike. I'm like ready to explode. So I'm going to go ahead and go now, but I just want to go ahead and just be sure to sign up for the webinar. I'm excited about seeing you all. Also, if you have any questions that you want me to answer offline, you can always private message me on YouTube. You can follow me on my Facebook page, which is at whatchelseaeats.com. I'm also over on Instagram. You'll be able to see some of the foods that I eat on a regular basis. I try to post every day, but I don't get to do that all the time just because of being busy. But I tend to eat some of the same things every single day. So I'm trying to let my diet have a little more variety so that it doesn't look so boring over there at What Chelsea Eats. But at least you can see. Thank you. I got to get back to work too. All right. Thanks so much for watching. Many blessings to you all. I hope you're doing well, and let me know what questions you have and what kind of videos you want to see. All right, take care, y'all. Bye.